about chatbots, about Frankenstein Factor. We concluded our series on artificial intelligence last year. And now we are working at digital happiness. And this series is about a new trend we see emerging, which is all about what do we want with technology? Why are we doing this? Why are you going to work? Why are you making a product, a service? So that question is the main theme of this new research report. And of course, one of the oldest trends in humanity is that we are fascinated by creating life. Maybe you've heard about the Greek mythology, Prometheus. He created mankind out of clay. And the new Prometheus is Dr. Frankenstein. He created this Frankenstein monster. And when he finally succeeded, he was really excited. But soon enough, he got scared, of course, of his own creation, because he created this thing, and as soon as he succeeded, then the interesting part started, because what do you want to do with this monster? Do you want to shake his hand? Do you want to hug him? Do you want to walk away? The interaction starts then. And I think that we are creating our own Frankenstein monsters and angels, and I think that's really fascinating. This is an example, Cosmo. It's a really cute little robot. And as human beings, we are really good at projecting our own feelings and emotions onto lifeless things. He only has a face and makes a bit of sound. So we can't help ourselves to make a connection with this thing, but it's nothing, of course. It's just some electronics, a few lines of code, and you could just stamp on it and nobody cares. But we are so prone to human faces, to human emotions. We see things that aren't there. Big or small, it doesn't matter. We can't help ourselves, and we project things of our own mind on lifeless things, and these lifeless things also trigger emotions in us. This is the new robot dog from Sony. It was released this month.
Hey, good boy. Oh, good boy, man. This is weird. This is good.
And this is the essence I'm talking about. This is weird. This is good. Those opposites, the emotions that get triggered. And to learn more about that, I want to dive into psychology, to be specific, existential psychotherapy. And this domain says that we as human beings have four basic existential fears. We are all afraid for social isolation, that we are rejected by the group. We are all afraid for a meaningless existence. We are all afraid for dying or getting hurt, and we are all afraid for ultimate freedom and the corresponding responsibility. If you are afraid for something, you also want something. So if I'm afraid for social isolation, that you guys reject me, I also want to be included in the group. So I have a need to be seen by you guys, to be accepted. And if I'm afraid for a meaningless life, I want my life to have purpose, to be needed. If I'm afraid of dying, I want to survive. And if I'm afraid for ultimate freedom, I want to control things. And I want to look at a few examples to make this more tangible. Take, for example, the fear for social isolation and the need to be seen. For thousands of years, we have fulfilled our need to be seen in the normal way, in society, in groups. And our fear for isolation, we've mitigated that by trying to be accepted by other people. And now suddenly, digital, virtual, holographic human beings challenge us if we want to connect with them. The clip I want to show you is called The Gate Box. It's $2,500. It's basically a little small human being that you put inside your home. It's connected to your smart home. It can turn on the lights, can turn on the heat. But it also sends you text messages when you are at work. It wants to make a relationship, to create a relationship with you. And my question for you guys is, do you think this is a solution for our fear for social isolation? Who of you wants to buy one? Yeah. Okay, too nice. I had to laugh about the top comment behind underneath this YouTube clip. It said, "This is so sad to watch. It literally hurt." but then it said, "So when can I get one?" So this is what we are doing in IT. Let's go to the next fear, the fear for a meaningless life and the need to be needed. A lot of people get purpose and a sense of meaning from their jobs. Sense of purpose from their jobs. And in IT, we are automating parts of jobs. We make things simpler. We outsource flipping burgers to a robotic arm. And you can imagine that the fear for a meaningless existence gets triggered when people read about these examples. If this is your job, you've done it for 20 years, you're really good at it, you're proud of what you do, you talk every day to your customers, every day to your colleagues, and suddenly your boss has a robotic arm. It's only logical that you fear that you are fearing that your life doesn't have purpose anymore. And then the third fear, that is the fear for dying. It's a really natural fear, of course. I think one of the most logical examples is superintelligence, singularity, all these dystopian Hollywood movies. They are triggering the fears of dying. And we heard a lot of warnings from Elon Musk, Bill Gates, Stephen Hawking, you name it. I think one of the strongest quotes is from Nick Bostrom. He's a really interesting philosopher, and he is saying that if you don't take this threat seriously, we will end up just like the gorillas. There will be a new intelligence on top of the food chain, and it will be telling us what we can and cannot do. And it's not about if you think that this fear is justified. It's about that this fear is getting triggered when people are reading about IT and artificial intelligence and that kinds of things. And then the fear for ultimate freedom. That's a really interesting one because, yeah, who would have thought that people are afraid for ultimate freedom? But it turns out that we really want to control things and we are really good at that as human beings. We are sitting here, everyone nicely on his seat. You are all dressed. We had a whole program. Everything we do is about controlling things. And the interesting thing is that in IT, we are outsourcing control to the systems. To a smart system or a dumb system, doesn't matter. And the clip I will show you is about a smart home. And you will see how we outsourced control of householding things.
Playing jazz.
Playing jazz.
Smoothie.
Making smoothie.
Calendar.
No meetings today. Remember, dentist at 9:30.
Fire off.
Fire off.
Open door.
Door open.
And we're gonna do one more.
Fire.
Open door.
Wrong voice command.
Open door.
Wrong voice command.
Open. Open door.
Repeat that.
Open door.
I didn't understand that.
Hey, open door.
Play on the floor. Sing on the
floor. Yeah, so that would be really annoying. So the more we outsource to artificial intelligence, the more could go wrong, of course. And I think this question is justified. Should we, what should we fear more, super intelligence or super stupidity? And all these examples, they are examples of robotica or virtual solutions that are mimicking human life or parts of human life. And they are triggering our fears and needs and challenges to fulfill our needs in new ways. And we have heard about innovation, for example, so it's only logical that this will happen more and more. For instance, with Google Duplex, you've probably heard about that one. Chatbots entering our phone conversations.
I'm happening out here. Hi, I'm calling to book a women's haircut for a client. I'm looking for something on May 3rd.
Sure, give me 1 second.
So, and people are laughing about the because that's so typical human thing to do. At least it was a typical human thing to do, because now chatbots do it as well. And a few days later, there were a lot of news articles that didn't like the and didn't like that the chatbot was deceiving people. Is that ethical to do? So Google quickly responded with this solution.
El Cocotero, how may I help you?
Hi, I'm the Google Assistant calling to make a reservation for a client.
So that's a really simple fix. Just be transparent about, hey, I'm a chatbot, I'm calling you. But that's not the root problem, I think. I think this is just a symptom, because the root problem is that a lot of developers knew about the demonstration before it was demoed. A lot of marketeers looked at the demo. Yeah?
A week after Google I/O, a research institute released a paper that they have made 50 phone calls to actual barbershops and used n-gram analysis to show that this conversation was nothing like making a normal appointment. So there was a big implication that the entire thing was fake.
So they all recognized that it was a chatbot and it wasn't as good as we showed.
It was most likely not an actual real machine-generated conversation.
Yeah. Yeah, I know the, if that's true, then still the point is there that nobody said, well, maybe it's a bit scary if we give every Android user a digital assistant that can fool human beings. I think we need to look to take these fears more seriously and to, yeah, to integrate people who think about that into our companies. And we are creating these parts of human beings, digital human beings, also by ourselves, not just the big companies. I don't know how many people have heard about Lyrebird. No, I see one smiling, so I guess you do. This is a neural network. You can speak sentences into Lyrebird. I think I spoke 60 sentences with my own voice, and now I can type in everything I want, and it sort of sounds like my own voice.
I'm the digital voice of Thijs Pepping. Nice to meet you all.
And is this perfect? No, not at all. Not at all. He has a big accent. I know. Okay, I have a big accent as well. But it's not perfect, of course, but it's good enough. Because this guy, he used it to trick his own mother.
So obviously what I want to do now is I want to try to use this to fool my mom into thinking it's me.
Hi.
Hey, how's it going?
Good, but how are you?
I only have a second here. Super busy. Just wanted to quickly check in and make sure we are still good for dinner tonight.
Yeah. 8:15.
Okay, sounds good. Text me when you arrive. Sound good?
Oh, great, Charlie. Thank you.
I'm using service right now. Love you. Bye.
Love you too.
So good enough to trick your own mother. And these digital entities are also entering social media. Who of you are on Instagram? I am. Few. Who of you have more than 1,000 followers? No? Okay, you're laughing. Yeah, me neither. I have 20 or something like that. But this girl, she has 1.4 million followers on Instagram. And this girl doesn't exist. She goes to the biggest events. She poses with celebrities. Every girl that follows her wants to be just like her because she's really cool, she's a trendsetter, and she doesn't exist. It's a photoshopped, made-up personality. And if I put it really strongly, I could argue that 1.4 million followers think she has more personality than you, and she doesn't even exist. I mean, 20 followers. What does this mean for the fear for social isolation when 1.4 million people are looking at a made-up personality and nobody is looking at me? You guys are looking at me. Thank you for that. And these technologies can also be used for bad purposes, of course. Deep fake videos like this one.
We're entering an era in which our enemies can make it look like anyone is saying anything at any point in time, even if they would never say those things. So, for instance, they could have me say things like, President Trump is a total and complete dipshit. Now, you see, I would never say these things, but someone else would. Someone like Jordan Peele.
So these technologies get easier to be used by normal people. This guy, Aviv Alfadia, is warning for an infocalypse. He's saying that in a few years, these technologies will be so easy to use that people are getting tired of asking the question, is this a real video? Is this a real image? Is it photoshopped or not? He's calling it reality apathy. So we don't care anymore. And we need to do something about this. We need to ask the question, who can we trust? Can we trust these digital identities that are entering our lives? Oh, this is just stupid. But to who do we have to look to for solutions? We used to look up to these guys. We thought they were God, and now more and more people think they are the four horsemen of the apocalypse. And I already see some signs for a counter movement, anti-technology people. And I think in some ways they are right. One of the most interesting counter movements is this anti-AI. It's a little device behind my ear, and it listens with everything what I do. So if Google really creates a good Duplex version and it calls me, then it analyzes the voice. And if it's a synthetic voice, it makes this thermoelectric plate that I put on my spine. It makes that really cold, so I actually get a shiver when I'm talking to a lifeless entity. So we've seen that these Frankenstein monsters and Frankenstein angels are triggering our needs and our fears in life. And we need to do something about it. And I think this is part of the solution. Psychology, looking at what human beings are striving for in life and taking that seriously. And then we can build for what we call digital happiness. We see this actually as a trend. A lot of people have different names for that. And this is all about the question, what do we want to build? There's a lot of technological possible right now. A lot of those possibilities are also financially feasible. But what do we want to do with it? What is socially desirable? I will show you a couple of examples why we are calling this a trend. We did our research in 2017. And in January 2018, suddenly Apple investors wrote an open letter to Apple, and they summarized a lot of research. It was a really good letter, and they said, we don't trust our children with your products anymore, because everyone is thinking about how can we get more clicks, how can we get more attention, how can we get more views on ads. So they were saying, your product is basically built to make our children more addicted, and you need to do something about it. Apple kind of listened. They came up with screen time. It's a monitoring tool of your own phone habits. Google is coming with digital well-being. It's a different name than digital happiness, but close enough. And it's just a small part of the solution, but we see things are emerging to do something about this. Humane Tech is also a really interesting movement. Ex-Google employees, people from Uber, people from universities come together, and they are sharing best practices about building for digital happiness. One of the founders is James Williams. I talked to him in Chicago a few weeks ago, and he is saying that technology should be a GPS for our life goals, for what we want in life as human beings. And at this moment, it's the only goals technology has is how many clicks did you get, how many time was spent on the site, and how many views did we get on the ad. And we need to bring that in line with other goals, like being together with people, becoming better in your hobby or in your job, going on vacation. Those need to become more in line. And in science, there's also a really interesting movement starting on a few places. This one started a few years ago in Australia. It's called positive computing. Rafael Calvo and Dorian Peters are the figureheads. And what they are basically doing is getting insights from psychology, from artificial intelligence, from human-computer interaction, and bring that together to think about how you can design in such a way that people come that people can be more creative, for instance, or feel more engaged in what they do. And what I learned from them is that digital well-being or digital happiness is a really big term, and you need to divide that up into different values like autonomy, relatedness, engagement. And you need to think about how can you create more engagement through this product. And that could be if you are creating a game or if you are educating someone, that the game automatically alters to the level of the player. So this is one of the takeaways I learned from them. And yeah, the last thing I want to share is our own report series on digital happiness. A lot of the people I just showed you, we have talked to them, we have shared our experience and vision with them, and we summarized that in our own report. It's a trend report for our clients, for Socrates itself. And our second report, the yellow one, will be published in 1 week. It's called In Code We Trust, and it's all about trust in IT and how we can how we can build for digital happiness. If you have one moment, then I will conclude. Then I will put. Thank you for your time. You have a question.
Digital happiness. Is there an age group that this is targeted towards? I'm past 60. I'm not on social. Everybody turned around. Oh my God.
Yeah.
I'm not on social media. I love the app where I can see what my bank account is and transfer money after the bank is closed.
Yeah.
I don't look for any contact with the world around me through social media. So I'm assuming that a lot of this is for a younger generation.
So you're saying you don't use social media, and therefore you don't feel any negative consequences of using technology?
I think I'm still in the old category that uses technology to do something for me.
Yeah.
I don't derive any benefits other than services from
it. Yeah, I think
it's not black and white. I understand that, but I'm just trying to understand: are we talking millennials? Are we talking
it's
people older than me that are shut-ins?
Yeah.
who are we talking about?
No, we are talking about everyone. And I understand that the social media thing really speaks for itself. But it's also about, do you want to, if you are an elderly, and loneliness is a big problem under the elderly. And then the question is, do you want to build a robot that they can engage with, or do you want to build a robot that is saying, well, I am not the end solution, but I will go to you, ask you to follow me, and then I will connect you to your neighbor, who is also an elderly lady who is lonely, and then you can talk to each other. It is about those questions.
Yes. And think of parents with crying kids. Like in the old days, they would give them a hug, and now they give them an iPad.
Yeah.
It's even across all ages.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. No, I mean I can see a lot of this for shut-ins and stuff like that. And that's why I'm kind of curious if there are different elements of the use of technology for different age groups.
Yeah, that's true. If you use technology differently, then digital happiness will have a different meaning. Yeah.
On the topic of info apocalypse, I got that right, how do you relate that to what was hyper reality from Baudrillard?
Then you need to explain hyper reality from Baudrillard. He is saying that we are creating replicas without a relationship to the source, right? And I think that you could place videos like deepfakes and such like that, you could place that in hyperreality, but I'm not sure if that's a one-on-one relation. What do you think yourself? Because you don't ask that question.
The theory of hyperreality came up during like the 70s, 80s, when there was a lot of, Cold War propaganda, a lot of different views and lots of different information feeds coming in, not computer generated, but still to human opposing views.
Yeah, the Soviet Union. Yeah.
Was real or not. That same thing is happening over here as well, except we're calling it differently and now it's machine generated.
Yeah, true. It's the same tactic. It's overloading people. it's overloading people with different versions of the reality, and they don't know what to choose anymore. We saw it happening with how was the airplane called? MH17. Russia showed us a lot of solutions every week. It was a different answer, and people didn't care anymore soon enough.
Yeah.
And now it's happening with deep fakes and such.
Yeah. I think it's a bit different because machines scale better. I think of 9/11, but with Twitter and Instagram and live feeds.
So the scale is different.
Yeah. The guy, Afif Ovadia, he's also saying that we are going into an age of automated laser phishing. He's calling that. So the phishing emails from Nigerian prince, they will evolve into automated chatbots that know exactly what your needs are and your fears. If I am fearing social isolation, the chatbot will know that and he will play into that. So that's also, if you are talking about scaling and Twitter bots and such. Yeah.
So all of us are working within the industry.
Yeah.
And how do we plug into social happiness, how do we incorporate that in our work?
Yeah, that's a good question.
Do I have any more?
Huh?
Do I have any more questions?
No. I think that's one of the most important questions. My work is mostly looking at the abstract level of what's going on in the world. So I don't have an answer for that myself, but the guys from Positive Computing, for example, they have written a book, and that's really interesting with a lot of design principles, and they are actually doing what you are asking for. How can I implement insights from positive psychology into my own work if I'm an architect or a developer? So people are doing that. And also humane technology. It's a the guy I showed, he started it together with another guy, and that guy already was an ethical designer at Google. So he was already asking these questions at Google. So there are people working on this. But yeah, how to bring it into your actually day-to-day life, I don't know, but this is a start.
It's not going to be in one of the future reports?
Maybe in our last one. We are thinking about doing that. Yeah.
You got applause for that answer.
All right. Well, thank you for your time, guys. Thank you.